Hi, this lecture is on Thomas Metcalf's Liberalism and Empire, the Age of Reform. I shall be delivering this lecture in three parts, both on account of clarity and also for the ease of video recording. My earlier lecture video on Thomas Hobbes took a long time to get uploaded. In the first part of the lecture, we shall look at the context of liberalism in England and some of the assumptions of the liberal dispensation. In the second part of the lecture, we shall discuss the views of James Mill and John Stuart Mill. Their views are important for two specific reasons. First, they used the liberal ideas to justify the British rule in India, and second, it was largely the views of these people that shaped the British reform in India. In the final part, we shall briefly look at the implications of liberal idealism in India during the British regime. Liberalism was a product of the Industrial Revolution and the growth of a new morality, as well as of Britain's worldwide predominance after its victory against the French in a series of wars, both in Europe and Indian subcontinent. These wars were known as the Napoleonic Wars. Therefore, liberalism is not just about how Britain's empire ought to be organized, but essentially it has provided a strategy for the remaking of Britain itself. During the early 19th century, when liberalism began to emerge, it was not a coherent ideology, and it was precisely this reason why Richard Bellamy, a political scientist, pointed out that it was a notoriously elusive notion and extremely difficult to define. Indeed, it incorporated a variety of heterogeneous views that anybody and everybody could be a liberal at that time. For instance, someone who believed in classical political economy, or let's say in free market, liked to identify as a liberal, and someone who was an ardent supporter of monarchy was also a liberal. However, there were a set of fundamental assumptions which were shared by most of the liberals. For instance, liberals conceived that human nature was intrinsically same everywhere, and that nature could be totally and completely transformed by the workings of law, education, and free trade. Liberals believed in the rationality of human beings as well as in the freedom of individuals. They wanted the people to lead a life of conscious deliberation and choice. Therefore, they sought to free individuals from their age-old bondage to priests, despots, and feudal aristocrats. So we are talking about, 18th and then early 19th century England, right? So people were, bonded to priests and then a lot of feudal aristocrats. Now, in any country, we come across institutions, especially the social institutions, that were set up or instituted a long time ago, usually several centuries ago. To give an example for the social institution from our country, caste is a social institution that was set up sometime during the ancient times, and we are still following it. Now, just as caste is a hierarchical social system, the 19th century England also followed a hierarchical social system which was based on class. Altogether, people were divided into three major classes. Aristocrats were at the top of the hierarchy, middle class was obviously in the middle, and the lower class was at the bottom. Generally, people are asked to respect or follow those institutions simply because they are there since antiquity. But liberals have had little sympathy with that kind of argumentation or assumed pride in such ancient institutions. For them, what shaped a good and a proper society was individual self-reliance, character and merit, and definitely not a hierarchy that rewarded individuals on the basis of patronage and status. Another important point is that all the liberals believed in the fundamental or total transformation of society. They never doubted that particular aspect. Equally, they never assumed that liberal ideas and values were applicable only to their society, basically to English society. They believed in the possibility of reform of all societies and universal applicability of liberal ideas and values. As the Victorian society and the polity was fundamentally hierarchical in nature, the espoused liberal ideas and values are progressive and liberative to a large extent. Particularly, they aim to weaken the dominance of the aristocrats and upper middle class over the people who were placed at the lower levels. Obviously, the liberalist ideas and values did not go very well with the established classes. If, for instance, like, you know, if somebody coming from lower caste and then, you know, if they say that, you know, annihilation of caste, obviously upper classes, upper caste would not like it. Similarly, there also, when liberals wanted to bring certain changes, the established classes like landed gentry and aristocrats, you know, did not like it. Some of the Parliament's acts of reforms, such as the Reform Act in 1832, which introduced a wide-ranging changes to the electoral system of England and Wales, Corn Laws between 1815 and 1846 that meant to impose restrictions on imported food and grain, the Public Health Act of 1875, which was also known as sanitary legislation and which meant to improve the sanitary conditions in a Victorian Britain, and reorganization of local government, all were vehemently opposed and contested by the aristocrats and the landed gentry and even by the urban workers. Although at that time Britain was far from a democracy, people were highly vocal and they could not be simply brushed aside. By contrast, the situation in India was completely different. The Indians, as the conquered people, could not as easily protest measures presumably introduced for their own benefit. Therefore, India indeed became some sort of a laboratory for the creation of the liberal administrative state. The idea was, if the measures undertaken by the British government in India, measures like state-sponsored education, the codification of laws, and selection of bureaucrats by a competitive exam, if these measures were to be successful, then they could make their way back to England. I shall stop here as a part one, then we will resume a part two later. Thank you.